Can everyone hear me okay?
It's a slightly awkward hiatus.
So excuse me. So thank you all for coming to the launch event of Clean Growth, How to Boost Business Energy Productivity. My name is Joshua Burke. I'm a research fellow here at Policy Exchange. Delighted to have an extremely distinguished panel with me. So we have Lord Deben, the Right Honourable Lord Deben, the Chairman of the Committee on Climate Change and former Secretary of State. We've got Laura Sands, former MP for South Thanet. She holds various titles, but she's also the member of the advisory panel on the Cost of Energy Review, amongst other things. We have Richard Brackenberg, who's the Senior Vice President of Distributed Energy and Onshore Renewables of the Green Investment Group. We have Penelope Ganay, who's the Group Energy Manager at Marks and Spencers. And last but not least, we have Bill Rees, who is the Head of Commercial Distributed Energy and Power at Centrica. So in terms of a running order, I'm going to give you a brief overview of the report, the key findings, and then I'll turn to our panel for their views on this, and hopefully for this time some Q&A from the audience. So I'll just set the context of energy efficiency and why we thought we'd do the report. So, why is energy efficiency needed? Well, there's energy policy is often framed as a trilemma of objectives, affordability, security of supply, and sustainability. So that's one reason energy efficiency is so critical. It's a really cheap and low cost means of achieving all of those three. And I know Laura has got views on the energy trilemma, and if we've got time, we'll turn to her later, and perhaps it's not quite, it perhaps should be framed in those three objectives anymore, but I'm sure Laura can give you her views on that. And then we also wanted to frame the report in terms of energy productivity and how that can contribute to wider industrial productivity and the synergies there between clean growth, the clean growth strategy and the industrial strategy really. And looking at energy efficiency as a means of reducing barriers to growth and maintaining international competitiveness. So that was really context of the report, why it was needed. And then the report looked at the size of the opportunity across two key areas. So the first one was demand reduction, your typical things that you could do, improve your lighting, for example, better building instrumentation and control. And then the second thing we looked at was demand shifting and grid services. So whether that was drought avoidance or DSR, demand turnup, for example, looking at the ways that businesses could access those alternative markets and get extra output per unit of energy, and that really fed into the productivity side of things. So not your typical energy efficiency measures, but your productivity side of things. And really what we wanted to do, I think it was important to make a distinction. So what we looked at in the report was the measures that had a 1 to 3 year payback period and the measures that had a payback period of greater than 3 years. And from our analysis, the energy savings, the carbon savings, and the monetary savings were far greater for projects with a payback period of beyond 3 years. So really we wanted to make that distinction and then look at the ways or what types of capital would be needed for those kinds of projects. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later. So the report is structured around four key barriers. The first one is around information and the policies that exist to overcome that, and where there are perhaps shortfalls, and what policy recommendations could be implemented to overcome those. So really, we looked at the role of ESOS in overcoming the informational barrier, and how effective that's really been in terms of driving board level action from the recommendations. And what was striking was that there's actually very little information that is available on ESOS to really quantify how successful it's been. And I know that since the report came out, there has been some information on ESOS. But again, even that was quite scarce. And there was one statistic that said it only increased board level interest by 40%. But it doesn't really quantify whether that translates into board level action still. So you know, there's this real disconnect between the interest that's involved and then driving decision making at the top. So I still think there's certainly some work to do on ESOS. And then we also looked at the role of the public sector and thought there was a strong role for public sector leadership and whether they could we could extend ESOS to cover those large institutions where the cost
where the energy efficiency measures are cost effective. So we looked at, we did an analysis of where the most savings could be made on a cost effective basis. And if you looked at the NHS or the military community, for example, you could get 4.5 terawatt hour saving per £1 billion spent, whereas the industrial sector, for example, was less than 1 terawatt hour saving per £1 billion spent. So certainly there's a real role for the public sector there. And also, if you look at examples, and we cite this in the report, if you look at examples from America, for example, under the Obama administration, public sector leadership there really drove the EPC market and scaled up tremendously. So certainly there's a role there for the public sector. The second chapter of the report, the second barrier we looked at was project economics, and looking at the various complex fiscal policies that overlap and perhaps don't send the right price signals. And a couple of the key recommendations there were to look at the CCAs and whether they could be perhaps more stringent, obviously being cognizant of the fact that we need to maintain competitiveness, but the majority of the information out there suggests that CCAs continue on as a business as usual approach. So we thought perhaps without jeopardising competitiveness, making those a bit more stringent would be a sensible way to go. And then secondly, and hopefully we might see something in the budget coming up, was long-term services here with the CPS. Whether we get that in the budget remains to be seen. And then finally, penultimately, the third chapter is on access to capital. I mentioned this, the importance of making this distinction between projects with a greater than 3-year payback period and those before. The ones with, although we should focus on both, the ones with a longer payback period have potentially greater savings to make on across carbon, energy, and money. So we really looked at what the barriers to third-party capital were. And access to capital in general is the most frequently cited barrier across all businesses, SMEs and large enterprises. So there really is a real driver for this. So we looked at what the barriers were. Numerous things came up, the accountancy rules and the inability to really understand what they were, both for public sector and private sector, accounting rules and how you account for debt. And what the issues were, what the reasons were for the gap between capital and projects. The capital often identify lack of projects, and projects identify lack of capital. This is space in between that needs, where focus needs to draw the two together. And what we came up with was taking learnings from the heat network delivery unit, for example, where the main output from that was around feasibility studies. And what we've suggested here is setting up a specific energy efficiency delivery unit that could focus on development capital to take the projects from that are perhaps slightly more embryonic and give them a little bit of expertise and development capital to take them to a point where they're investment ready. So that was perhaps one of the biggest policy recommendations from the report. And then the last issue, the last barrier that we looked at was around split incentives. So we looked at this across two dimensions. The first one was the landlord-tenant split, and the second one was the internal split incentive between departments within businesses, for example. So looking at the first one, we advised it's a combination of tighter regulation of fiscal policy with recommendations of linking EPCs to business rates, for example, on the fiscal side, and on the regulatory side of things, making the EPC standards perhaps a little bit more ambitious and making that D by 2025. And in terms of the internal split incentive, there's often this competing objective between departments, ones who look at CapEx and ones who look at OpEx, for example. It's really about harmonising what the objectives of each department are, and really rephrasing that in the context of strategic investment. And that's, the research suggests that's perhaps the main driver at the board level on energy efficiency, is whether it fits into the wider strategic investment and corporate goals. So that's the general overview of the report. I'm now going to turn to my theme panel for views on energy efficiency. Lord Evan.
Well, thank you very much. I first of all want to say how important I think it is for us to be talking about energy efficiency. It always seems to me that there's almost a sort of psychological problem with energy efficiency, which is that particularly Tory politicians like big things that they can see and point at. So they like to build nuclear power stations and similar things, because somehow or other you can't you can't make much of energy efficiency. And I think very strongly that we have to go on and on about it, because it is the hidden and terribly important thing. And also it's very important for the public. When we started in the Climate Change Committee to look not at the cost of energy, but energy bills, of course, what we discovered was that although people are paying £9 a month more on their bills in order to do the green measures that we want, they get their bills are £20 a month less because of the energy efficiency of their new equipment, because their new boilers, because of their new toasters and the rest of it. And I think that before James Dyson opens his big mouth again, you might just think about the argument he had with his vacuum cleaners complaining about the European Union, perfectly right thing, which was to say it's perfectly technologically possible to deliver the goods, but using less energy. That's exactly what we've done across the piece. And that's why I was all pleased at the front page, you've got it there, let me help. The front page had this thing, because the great point about this was that what we discovered was that we were always talking to people about energy efficiency at the wrong moment. There's no point in talking to people about energy efficiency, and in most cases, unless they're about to do something. And if you talk to them then, always, they do it in a much more efficient way. So the year that these things came out on white goods, for example, on that year, you could go in and try to, I looked at it myself, you'd go in and try to buy, for example, a Chess freezer, and you would find that there were Chess freezers from anything from A to G. 2 years later, there was nothing that wasn't A, A plus, A double plus. Because what people had discovered was that once you ask that question at the point at which the sum of money involved becomes sensible, and in the proper sense, that one saw that it was valuable, then people make the right choices. So my first point is that I think that's important. The second thing is, I think one bit I would have liked to have more of in this report was about what I call the really painful institutional reasons why things don't happen. For example, Britain has taken so little interest in this that we were not there to push and push for the European Standards Institution to change the standards about accountancy. It's not just the incomprehensibility of those standards, but some of them are actually wrong. And one of the reasons why the United States has been so much more successful at getting energy efficiency in the public and private sector is simply because you can account for it in a sensible way. So that if you borrow the money in order to do energy efficiency action, and you pay for that borrowing out of the savings in the energy efficiency, that doesn't go onto your debt. It's a perfectly reasonable self-financing operation. We don't have that, and you can't therefore do that. And quite a lot of small companies particularly can't increase their debt, and local authorities and others have often not done what could be done simply because the government follows the accounting rules instead of getting them changed. Well, now they are being changed, but they're not being changed because the British government's done anything about it. They're being changed because other people have done something about it. No doubt, the British government will then say, there you are, there's another excuse for not liking Europe. Done absolutely sweet FA about that. And the same is true about certain other very simple, small things where institutionally we make energy saving very difficult. And one of those is the way in which we have our regulations as far as local government borrowing are concerned. Another is the way in which we think about the National Health Service, where we don't set these standards at all. We don't seek to do that. There's no central effort at doing those things. And that is very much covered in this document. So I want just to finish with the last thing, which isn't in this document, because it's not really part of its coverage, but energy efficiency. The biggest issue will in the future be, of course, the retrofitting of buildings that we've got already. So if we're going to have to do that, for goodness sake, stop making the problem worse. Every year we build 200,000 houses which are crap because they do not meet the standards which they could meet, and if they did meet, would reduce the costs of housing for everybody who lives in them. Because if you pay a bit more, and it is a very small amount more, to produce a house at passive house standards, and then you add the energy costs per month to the slightly increased mortgage costs, you'll find that you're better off to build it that way. Why is Persimmon? Why is you can go through every one of them, but the three biggest ones, which after all are Barratt's, Persimmon and Taylor Wimpey, why are they building houses now which are cheating the public from the proper cost? Big notices up, mortgage £495 a month. Not true. The reality of the cost of that house ought to add the cost of the energy necessary. And in that case, these are the companies that ought now to be building to passive house standards. You take Hasto, the very important local housing association. They have now built 11 of these passive house estates. And the result of that is they've given to their tenants the ability to pay their rent because their energy costs are so much lower. And so I end by just this point. We've got to think seriously about energy efficiency, not just in the context of dealing with climate change, not just in the context of the pressures of Paris. I want us to deal with energy efficiency in the context of ordinary people's bills. And if that is the case, we really have to remove those institutional barriers to people actually having a better, cheaper life and a warmer life. I'm not a Puritan. I don't think we're better off cold. I do happen to think we ought both to save the planet and keep ourselves warm.
Thank you, but it's always impossible to follow Lord Deepin, but I was very pleased to be his assistant with the props. This is a great and interesting report, and I might take a little bit of a different dimension, but some of the highlights, I think this issue about the misalignment between landlords and tenants is absolutely crucial and absolutely totally distorts the market. John's point about what sort of homes are we building today? Are we building in the fuel poor for the future? And that is absolutely unacceptable. But I look at this, I'm interested in this word productivity because it's a little bit different from efficiency. And productivity, I've always been a bit accusing of the energy system itself. So the consumer, as Joshua has actually rightly said, has done a lot of the heavy lifting over the last 30 years. They have improved efficiency through white goods, I mean not on them themselves, but by purchasing the right products. And there have been all sorts of consumer interventions and in the industrial sector. But from the power station to the plug, we are only 46% productive. So we are losing 54% of the energy generated to the energy utilised. And we have never had a regulatory regime that's actually borne down on that particular loss. In many ways, we have lots of disincentives which are not ensuring and not driving the energy sector itself to employ the right technologies, to be more efficient throughout the whole process. So, for example, one of the DNOs invested about sort of £600 million and saved about £2 billion worth of energy, right, through their system enhancement. When it came to their next regulatory review, they lost 98% of that value. So innovation has never been encouraged, and I think we need to really look at that very carefully because the system is not delivering value at the plug. The second issue is, and because Joshua sort of set me up for this, that trilemma. Well, I think the trilemma is dead and buried.
Yeah.
And I think it's a very good thing too. First of all, the whole idea that policy was one trade-off against another, actually they're all ambitions. Decarbonisation should be totally taken off the table because it is a given. The issue is not whether it's going to happen, it's the speed at which it will and must happen. The second issue is cost. Well, you know, it's interesting if you start to look at the costs of renewables. We are now getting to a very, very efficient, effective, and to be frank with battery, a super system optimized renewable sector. So the cost is going to come down in terms of the generation. The issue will be a lot to do with the system design and the distribution. And the third issue is my favorite, which is security of supply. Now, I'm sure John saw this, but many ministers of energy have this conversation with the energy sector. Minister, the lights will go out. And what's going to happen? Well, I'm afraid I think we've got to relook and re-examine this term security of supply. Firstly, stop turning always to generation as the answer. What about innovation? What about efficiency? What about productivity? Secondly, actually, it's always been overblown. Thirdly, when you start to look at this generation of response, most failures are actually down to the distribution level. And fundamentally, we have got to start thinking very, very differently about a productive energy system. So in my last minute, I've just published a report as well, which is actually about optimizing the energy system. So instead of looking at it as a generate, distribute, deliver, with a nice victim called the consumer at the end of it, we're looking to actually create equality between demand and supply through the new introduction, the new sector that is really going to blow the mind of the energy sector, and that is data. Not that simple little data you get from an energy meter, but the data that you get from consumer demand. And we can drive a much more productive system that actually constantly is looking to deliver more from less. And until we look at that system and not trapped by the incumbent infrastructure we've got and start in many ways shaping a modern, productive, and super decarbonated system, we're going to be trapped by a 1950s business model that in many ways, as you can see by the share prices, is already being traded out of. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Trouble. By way of quick background, the Green Investment Group and its predecessor, the Green Investment Bank, have been investing in energy efficiency projects for the past 5 years and upward of 30 individual projects we've invested in. This particular report today, we think, is really helpful to highlight again the opportunity that represents in the broader energy efficiency space and in energy productivity in particular. Not only in, notwithstanding whether or not the trilemma is dead or not, but not only in addressing a version of the trilemma, but also we think in creating a vibrant asset class and investment class in energy efficiency projects, which in turn, and we'll come back to that briefly in a moment, will create a bit of a very positive feedback loop in creating an energy efficiency opportunity in the market. I wanted to pick up on a couple of, a couple of points highlighted in the report, and you won't be surprised to hear, as an investor, I'll be picking on the finance side. But in particular, how third-party capital can help overcome some of the barriers that Josh has identified in the report. And let me start by saying this is not just capital in an amorphous sense. I think what's key in this sector is for capital to come in early in the life cycle of a project. We talked earlier about the gap between capital and projects, and I think early involvement of capital can help overcome and can help shrink that gap between the two. So really three elements where early involvement of third-party capital we think can help address some of the barriers. Firstly, in helping reduce the upfront hurdle for companies and businesses to consider these projects, and specifically where investors look to finance the development phase of projects. And very concrete terms, that's financing feasibility studies, investment grade audits, that can help reduce that hurdle, which, you know, can go into the hundreds of thousands of pounds for businesses to even consider this as an opportunity. So that really addresses the upfront hurdle. Secondly, ensuring that capital is involved at the outset, together with delivery partners, the likes of Centrica, and hosts, the likes of Marks and Spencer's, but ensuring that capital is at the table at the outset ensures that the risk allocation as between those three parties is identified and appropriately allocated up front, which ensures projects are bankable and stand the test of time. So both of those key elements, the upfront involvement in the development phase and in ensuring the appropriate risk allocation, I think it goes quite a way in helping overcome that perennial debate about capital's looking for projects, projects are looking for capital, really getting in early. I always think about the renewables sector some 10, 15 years ago. That sector wouldn't have been anywhere without some of the development capital and the developers that, that have been active in that space. What energy efficiency needs, I think, is early involvement and almost developers of these projects. So whether that's the private sector doing that or indeed an energy efficiency delivery unit helping public sector address that, I think is one way forward. And then let me conclude on my end in highlighting that tapping the third party capital, the deep pools of capital out there, we think can help overcome that other barrier that Josh has highlighted in the report, which is the competition for internal capital. In many ways, companies should be using their scarce internal resources to focus on their core business, whether it be opening up a new retail chain, a new production line, and look to external capital to help accelerate these energy efficiency investments, as opposed to having the poor old energy manager being drip-fed some capex budget every year to replace some lights. Bring all of that up front, generate the savings, and bring them, fast forward them effectively. And in many ways, the longer payback projects, the ones that are longer than 3 years, turns out that infrastructure investors out there, they're very happy with longer term returns. And so I think there's a natural coming together between those, that opportunity in the projects that have a longer payback and those deep sources of capital that are out there that, that want to get in there. So let me conclude by saying that, again, commend Josh and the team for highlighting this opportunity, and think that finance can be a key enabler in helping achieve these energy productivity goals.
Brilliant. Thank you very much.
Talking about energy efficiency, we've done, I would say, in capital planning, we don't think. Sorry, I've lost my train of thought just there. We've been heavily investing, I suppose, in capital, as you say, it started off 10 years ago, so most of our low-hanging fruit has already been achieved. But I should say, forming a really clear investment program is key to it. We actually usually do a 3-year plan, so when we set a new target, we actually plan the whole 3 or 5 years till that target out. So we outline and put a business case together and say, to achieve that next target, we need to invest X million to get there. Projects that we've done recently would include investing heavily in LED lighting across retail, also things like AC fans, which change the speed, variable speed light fans on our refrigeration. And despite a couple of the other things we heavily invest in, is actually in our people and in training them how to be more energy efficient. So I don't know if the report actually even covers that, but a lot of energy efficiency is actually related to our behaviours, not just to the equipment in which we use. Also, talking about security of supply, we also invest heavily in what we call demand-side management and in using our diesel generators, whether it's right or wrong. We also are looking to shift the cost or our supply to save money and also reduce and how I can add to what they've said. Generally, I've lost my train of thought. If you don't mind me for a moment.
Yeah, that's okay. We'll come back to you.
We'll come back to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So, Phil Rees from heading the commercial team in Centrica Business Solutions. I echo a lot of what's been said, really. I think the report picks some real key challenges to seeing energy efficiency rolled out across the industrial and commercial estates and with business customers. I think, just picking up a point that Laura made, I think Centrica has definitely seen the change in the market coming, and we've restructured our business to focus on the fact that the whole energy infrastructure is changing, and which is why we've actually made a number of acquisitions. To help industrial and commercial customers essentially manage their bills and take advantage of the new revenue opportunities in that space. But I think one of the things, so my role, I've got a team of people in a commercial team within the UK and I, Centrica Business Solutions team, and we've got a team of engineers, a team of analysts, and a team of commercial managers who are essentially there to try and work with customers to identify opportunities on their sites that they can do to reduce their bill and maybe take more advantage of opportunities available. I think the report highlights a number of different things that are challenging for customers, and I've been working in this space for 7-8 years on doing this, and it's actually one of the hardest spaces to sell anything into. And I think one of the things that the report picks up on is the kind of misalignment of incentives between different people within an organisation. And if I kind of take an example of a customer in the industrial space, manufacturing customer in the West Midlands, they've got an energy manager. He spent the last sort of 7-8 years doing his job, focusing on how do I make savings year on year. So all he does, all he's been doing, all he's got the authority to do is to go to his supplier and say, do this for me cheap, a little bit cheaper next year. And each time he squeezes the supplier a little bit more. But there's only so far you can go. There's very little margin in that space for industrial commercial side to actually squeeze any more. So a few years ago, we go to that particular customer and say, look, we've got a £5 million investment opportunity. We can save your energy, about less than 3-year payback, and also you can take advantage of some of the new revenues and cost savings from demand side management. How about it? The energy manager kind of jumps up and thinks he's going to be a hero in his organisation. Brilliant, he can get fantastic returns. He takes it to his site manager, who says, okay, I think it's okay, but I'll have to go and get sign up from the global FD. Goes up to the global FD, who says, well, this is non-core investment, it doesn't really fit within what we're trying to do. This doesn't fit within our investment space, so no. Okay, we go back, talk to some of our funding partners and think, right, we'll go back with a funded solution, so it's not competing with his internal capital. And basically come up with a solution where the customer just pays for the savings they get, so they're not paying anything around the actual capital, they're just paying for the kind of OPEX saving, essentially, and they get to keep a big share of that. Energy manager loves it, takes it to his site manager, says, okay, goes up to the group FD, and again he says, not sure really, because how can I compare this with my internal sources of funding, if it's a good value or not? Let's spend some time thinking about it, and then actually better get the auditors comfortable that it works from a balance sheet perspective. 6 months later, just about getting them comfortable, he changes his auditor under the new rules. His auditor comes in and says, actually no, this is not off balance sheet at all, it's on balance sheet. Start all over again, come up with a new solution, new structure. And then you kind of get the FD comfortable. Okay, he's just about comfortable. It's been a hard work. You've kind of, 18 months has gone by. You could have almost paid some of the equipment off by now, but actually, it's just, that's where he's at. And then he says, fine, comfortable with it. Then it has to go to the global procurement head to get sign off from there. And woe betide the person who goes to the global procurement head with an innovative solution, because he wants to kind of rip it all apart and start again and tender each part of the component separately. So then you kind of go through another 6-month process. And he then has got to come up with a solution where we do a pilot just to test it. It's a £1 million investment, and then it's got a 1-year payback. So by the time we're actually at the place, we haven't even done the deal yet. We've now got to pull together a landlord pack to get the landlord comfortable with the solution, and we're sort of going through that process, and he can't understand why on earth we want to do this on his site, and we've only got 8 years left on the lease and didn't feel comfortable. So a highlight of all the different obstacles with one particular customer, where the energy manager is sort of screaming to do this opportunity, the rest of the organisation is facing in so many different ways. And I think the report kind of highlighting this and some of the incentives that need to change around it, I think is absolutely key. And I know that's just within the business. I've had the same experience in large parts of the public sector, you get the individuals, some individuals are absolutely closest to the coalface who are totally behind it and push it. But the internal bureaucracies and as a misalignment of incentives is an absolute barrier to getting anything done in this space.
Josh, if I may just pick up on that very briefly. I think the point, certainly from our perspective, getting in at the highest possible level with the customer, you know, ends up being, you know, finding that sponsorship at board level, which is where we had some hope that ESOS would help with that, but finding that sponsorship at board level is pretty key. And in some ways, you almost want energy efficiency to become that all-pervasive thing, much like the HSE is, just something that becomes completely pervasive around an organization, that everyone is aligned from the board level down to the factory floor about something like HSE or energy efficiency. That, to me, feels like an ambition and that we should all be going for.
Brilliant. Thank you all for the panel, and particularly for bringing to life some of those barriers with the examples from the workplace. We've got 20 minutes for Q&A, and thank you for being brief for that. As Chair's property, I'm going to ask one question and then I'll turn to the floor. So if you had one ask, either to the Chancellor or to Claire Perry, on energy efficiency, what would be that one thing you would like to see done, either from a policy point of view or something to overcome some of the barriers that have been mentioned just now?
Set in government regulation that within 5 years all houses have to be built to a passive house standard of one sort, to a passive house standard. That would mean that we're not piling up problems for ourselves in the future, and would in fact mean that people have cheaper housing.
I mean, I love your tenant and landlord misalignment. I would make that very much around business rates. And I would incentivize companies, landlords, to have their rent actually with all utilities bundled together. And once you've got a bundled product, then it is absolutely in the landlord's interest to bear down on those costs and to drive efficiencies. And actually, it's also much more useful for the company itself because they've got a fixed cost overhead and they understand that there is very little volatility.
I'm picking up on anything to help create more focus at board level on the energy efficiency question, whether it's getting to a level of cultural change that we've seen in the health and safety space, something that would help that.
Anyone have been your key barriers so far?
I would say, well, not necessarily in Marks and Spencer's, but in general for industry, I believe incentivizing people through ESOS. Mm-hmm. Currently, everybody produces reports and they come out with findings of what they should be investing in, but you're not actually incentivized to do anything about it. You show it to your board and then they can just ignore it. So I believe there needs to be a way that's written policy that you actually have to do, implement some of these.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think Richard picked up on the sort of culture that needs to change. And I think that's really important. The government it needs to lead by example. And the number of situations I've seen where government has opportunities but it doesn't fulfill them for various reasons. It needs to see this with a real kind of a hunger, I think, in the public sector space, and set the tone that which the private sector can help.
Brilliant. I'm going to turn to the audience for questions. If you could state your name and organisation, that would be much appreciated. And if you could keep it to a question rather than a statement, that would be also really appreciated. So, any hands there? Yes. This gentleman there.
Yeah, Sam from Impax Asset Management. Obviously, there are some particularly challenging issues for energy efficiency investments. Getting scale of non-standard projects is really a challenge. It's not particularly in the renewables space. It's also a lack of investment track record that asset owners can point to around the world. So I wonder whether you could comment on three ideas. Number one, this is a very amorphous topic, so can we potentially focus on the public sector, because there's huge improvement potential there, and there's some scalable, standardised sectors like public lighting, like schools, where you can make a large number of projects that are quite similar, scale quite quickly. Secondly, with Brexit, there is an opportunity for thinking to be done around institutions, and the EIB is not going to be able to help the UK. Is there scope for a replacement of the EIB to most recently in the school sector. I think there could be some scope there for adding more capacity to Salix to help with energy efficiency improvements in the education space. And third idea is on disclosure. So with the task force for financial related to climate disclosures, then there's going to be a lot of pressure on corporations for disclosure around climate change. Could we make sure that any UK legislation weaves in energy efficiency and potentially comply or explain type requirement around TCFD?
Thank you. Who's got a burning desire to tackle that?
Perhaps I could just pick up on the first component of that question around aggregation and standardisation. I agree, and you've been active in this space for longer than I have, but the aggregation game with energy efficiency comes down to some form of standardisation of contracts, which you know, there are initiatives out there to help overcome some of those barriers, whether it's initiatives like the Investor Conference Project. So that's one element to it. Aggregating smaller individual projects isn't necessarily, I think it's a question of route to market of finding the right partners for that, whether it be the people who have those customer relationships, the likes of Bill and his team, or others who have a natural touch point with customers. I think that is spot on. We are focused on projects that are probably 10 to 20 million pounds. Recognise that for a lot of corporates that there is a smaller, there will be projects with smaller amounts there. So finding a way to make the transaction costs work on a smaller project is going to come down to standardising, making the process as efficient as possible to state the obvious. But that requires some discipline on the part of the customer as well.
Brilliant. And in terms of replacement to the EIB, does anyone have a view on that?
I mean, could I make a sort of broader point about government? I think the scale issue is really, really important because that creates standardisation, that creates mechanisms, and the market will find those right things as long as we can kick off scale. Now, I might have got the figures wrong, but when I was a bag carrier at DEC, there was a proposal there, which I think was a £2 billion investment by the Treasury to totally upgrade the whole of the public sector buildings and estates, and it was going to deliver within 4 years £25 billion worth of returns in the sense of energy reduction. Now, if that sort of level of ambition was put out there, it would start standardising all these products, it would create lots of different securitisation fallouts, and it would be really, really exciting. The one figure that I don't know whether Josh put in his report, but I haven't seen it that often quoted, and that is every pound of energy that we save an additional pound in energy systems costs and investment. So if the government even invested, let's say, 25p in this, i.e. de-risked it by 25% for a company or an organisation to do some energy security, energy efficiency, the economy, the society, and our bottom line as from economy wide would be £1 better off. So I think we've really got to get to the Treasury and understand and get them to understand the huge productivity benefits for the economy in its wider sense.
Of course, their problem is that they pay out the 25p and they don't save the other bit, and they don't really believe in the other bit.
No.
So I think the three things that just come out now. The first thing is, you notice that from two totally different points of view, if you create the situation in which the bill is a proper bill for the whole of the cost of occupation, whether it's for the domestic or for the business occupier, you make a huge difference to people's understanding of it. So that's a first common thing. The second thing is that if you standardise things, whether it's, if you take the house building one or the systems, the package which you might have for investment, if you standardise things, the cost comes down absolutely enormously. The latest figures look as if, and we've got to test them against the most rigorous, but it looks as if that if you actually insisted upon passive level housing, then in fact the cost would not go up, because the costs, the extra costs are that you have got specially made bits and pieces at the moment, whereas if you build your average crap house, what you do then is to have bits and pieces which are made on an assembly line. As you know, much of a house building is not on the spot, it's bits that you bring in from outside. So immediately you replace the mechanism from bespoke to mass produced, you can get the price down to a comparable price. But once you start talking about that, you change the whole picture. And that's why I think those two elements that have come through as a common view right across the board, not just business, but as far as the normal consumers concerned, are very important, which leads to the third one, is that if you get that culture together, and that's why I don't ever want to divide the normal consumer, the house owner, the rent payer, from the business consumer, because you need to have a common view that this is really important. That enables you to get the third missing point, which is you can spend all the money you like on re-engineering things and organizing the most energy efficient buildings. But if you don't have people who run those buildings properly, you can easily get back to the same problem in the first place. So you really do have to include people in the package you present.
On the EIB question, I kind of wanted to explore with Richard a little bit, I guess, but for me, I don't see there being a shortage of capital looking for projects in this space. The challenge is how you actually get that capital into the projects. Problem. So, I think maybe that's where there is a role for government to lead and try and make that possible, whether it's through accounting standards or through driving this, as I said, cultural change. That maybe is where the emphasis needs to be, rather than providing a new pot of capital. I think it's about actually, we get banks talking to us all the time asking for projects. It's more actually then once you come up with them, how you get it in the way that works for the customer, for the landlord, for all the component parts. That is the challenge, is kind of connecting.
I mean, so especially ensuring the finances there up front to ensure that the risk allocation works for everyone, but this is the point you made.
Yeah.
Educating the investor community on what the attractions are of these projects, and also just being conscious that certain sources of non-commercial capital could, say this was mentioned, but could generate a situation where people wait for the next allocation and don't explore viable commercial options. It's probably a case to blend that with a commercial option, but you need to be careful about creating pots of capital that don't drive the perennity of a long-term sustainable financial product.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about an RHI example where we developed a ground source heat pump solution with a customer. To hit RHI parameters, and then the RHI was removed, and the technology we'd built actually didn't work from a standalone basis. And it was kind of government policy that led us down that track, and when the kind of pot was taken away, then the project falls away. Where actually, if we probably thought about how we make it commercially viable in the offset, rather than thinking about how we use government, build it to get the government support, actually we might have something a bit more sustainable.
Yeah, agreed. I'll take a couple of questions in a row. The gentleman down here, the lady there, Alf, and the gentleman behind.
Thank you very much. Fiona Matthews from the Earth Champions Foundation. I'd like to ask the panel, as we discussed that last element, about bringing congruency between the business community and the everyday people. How do you think we can engage the public to be excited and understand how to change behavior? Because they want to. They watch the news. They're highly alarmed about climate change, but there are very few models for them to follow. How do you see this becoming possible? Because if you get them behind you, you'll have a much stronger driving force and a lot easier way of bringing in the 2020 commitments for Paris. Thank you.
Cheers. Gentleman here, Ralph, you're
Hi there. Jonathan Lee, I'm the environment editor at the Sunday Times. And this is a question about carbon accounting. So a few years ago, I looked at the accounts submitted to the Carbon Disclosure Project for some oil companies, and in one year, one of the big companies, either Shell or BP, put in accounts that said it is emitted, I think it's 1.2 billion tonnes of CO2 equivalent. And then the accounts that came in the following year that had gone down to something like 50 million tonnes.
Well, they work very hard.
Well, the issue was accounting standards, and the basic point was that they could make up their own accounting framework as they went along. And it kind of illustrates a more general point, which was a lack of standards in carbon accounting. And I just thought, whilst there aren't standards, or where there aren't standards, it becomes very hard to make comparisons between companies, or even between the same company from year to year. So I wonder what opinions you've got on the need for improved carbon accounting standards. And I'd actually say that probably applies to national level as well, where you have the National Atmospheric Emissions Inventory, which has been proven to have failed absolutely on the pollutant emissions like nitrogen dioxide, despite what they've been supposedly measuring. And yet, it's also responsible for measuring CO2.
Thank you. And Ralph, one more question back. Thank you.
Hi, it's Craig Nelson from Tech UK. Just had a quick question about the panel. Look, have they got any examples from abroad of good policy, good, you know, efficiency measures that UK government could adopt here? I mean, you're seeing sort of scrappage schemes, for example, for smart appliances. You're seeing, you know, some people insist on sort of, you know, new home standards that go way above and beyond kind of what they do in the UK. Are there lessons from abroad that we can take here?
Thank you very much. So just to recap, how can we bring businesses and civic society closer together and engage them more? How can we increase transparency of carbon accounting, and what policies from abroad could we perhaps learn something from? Anyone?
I'm happy to take the behavioural change dimension. I mean, I think that really, when you start to look at it, the public have actually engaged quite a lot in as much behaviour change as we should be actually requesting them to do, because I actually think the system is delivering them rather a sort of loose and lazy product at the plug. There is an issue, of course, around cold homes, and John's point about how, you know, we're delivering people long-term energy insecurity. We've got to give people the information so they can deliver the plan, the campaigns to stop it. So, you know, we should have the no cold homes campaign. You know, I don't want to buy a cold home, but if you sort of say, well, it's, you know, got a rating of X, Y, and Z, that doesn't mean anything to me. But I am not going to put my last penny into this enormous investment, which is going to be my lifelong investment, and I'm going to find myself in a cold home. So I think we've got to be more explicit about what people really are buying. I always wanted to put, you know, those very sort of those plasma TVs, I wanted to put little labels on them saying, I am a thief. Because actually, on standby, they are costing you, I mean, they're totally out of, you can't buy them anymore, but some lower income families have still got these things in their homes, and they are putting their fingers in your purse every single day and taking between £3 and £5 on standby every single day. Now that is a criminal product, actually. But what we haven't done is been explicit enough. And in some ways, there are very few campaigns, NGOs, that actually talk about this, other than in a carbon way. They don't talk about it in a consumer way.
I think that's the point, is they talk about it in a carbon way. And there is so much that ought to be talked about in a consumer way, which is why shifting from the cost of energy to the energy bills was so important for the Climate Change Committee, because it recognised that we had to communicate with the general public. It's very important. But it seems to me that the point you make about the accuracy of these figures is a much wider one than that. And I think the more that we try to get people to understand the issues we have, the more we are absolutely bound to get these standards much more effective. For example, it is widely said, although I've not seen the proof of it, it's widely said that the way in which we measure the energy efficiency of homes is entirely open to fiction, simply because what happens is that you measure the energy efficiency of a standard type of home, let's say one called the Cotswolds, which, as you know, we build build a home called the Cotswold and you measure it, a standard copy of it, well, it would be not surprising if the one you measured was the very best one that you could build. You then build that all around the country, and very few local authorities then go along and have a look at that when it is built to see whether there is a direct comparison between the standard figure, that it does meet the minimum efficiency code, and the reality. And so part of it is not just getting the basis right, that you're really comparing like with like, but it is also making sure that what you say about it is actually true. And I do think that cutting back on local authorities and national surveillance in that sense is extremely damaging, because one of these days it will blow up, and the trouble is that all human beings will then disbelieve all the other figures, because once you know something about these arrangements, you become very leery about other claims. So I very much think your point is a very important thing to get right.
Does anyone else have anything to add?
I suppose just on the international precedents, you've alluded to it as well, Josh, but I think many people in the room here would, you know the US market will agree that Obama's executive orders to get the federal sector to really start, or give them a mandate, and to give the energy manager in the federal agencies the mandate to be able to stick their head above the parapet and actually engage in these energy performance contracts has been instrumental in getting that market going.
I actually just echo some of that as well. We talked a bit about it, the accountancy standards in the US as well really support both public and private sector doing something about it. And we compare our US business and our business in the UK. I mean, I seem to spend many, many more hours talking about accountancy with customers, internally, externally, with everyone, with their auditors. And actually, my US colleagues don't have the same issue at all. I think they can focus more on the actual, the technology and what they're selling to the customer.
Helen?
So, back on the behaviour question, I think there is actually a lot of,
Just quickly to touch on the point of engaging civil society, I think the Clean Growth Strategy announced the linking of green mortgages to building properties for the domestic sector, so I think it's probably quite a good route to engage them in that respect. And Barclays have recently announced, I think, a £500 million bond to do just that, so hopefully that will kickstart some momentum there. We are very short of time, I'm waiting for a signal, so I'll get one more question if anyone has a. Anyone has one? And if not, I will say a massive thank you to our panel and a big thank you to the Green Investment Group and Centre for supporting this project.